and by him all things were made. Above all things is he, and by his name are we at peace through his blood. I'm alive, my sin dead, I've been reborn again. I'm complete, made whole, being restored by you, Jesus is above all things, and he proved that he was God. He rose from the grave and defeated death.
Got it, Anna. Good morning, Life Share Church. Those that are here and those that are watching online, let's worship the Lord together. Come on, stand to your feet.
Waking up from the longest night, fixing my eyes on a new horizon. Joy before me, leave the past behind. There's no turning back, there's no turning back. Boldly I run into your presence, faith like a child, known and protected here in your arms. My shame is unraveling, unraveling. Skies. Now I'm dancing in the light of heaven. Grace has found me, brought me back to life. There's no turning back, there's no turning back. Boldly I run into your presence, faith like a child, known and protected here in your arms. My shame is unraveling, unraveling.
Of the blind, there's no one like you.
is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, oh, our God, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, thank you, Lord.
Sing into the darkness.
Into the darkness you shine, and out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. Oh, there's none like you. Yeah. And our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is here. Summon power, our God, oh, our God, yeah. And our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, oh, our God, yeah, yeah. Oh, our God is stronger. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? With us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Oh, oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, yeah, yeah. Then what could stand?
Thank you that there is nothing that can stand against us, God. Lord, because you are for us, God, you are with us. And we thank you that we can move forward in you. And we thank you for your presence in this place, Lord. Oh, we thank you for your presence wherever we are today, for those that are watching. Lord, that you would touch each and every heart, God. Lord, that you would bring your healing to every single life, God. Lord, that you would bring a spirit of hope, God, a spirit of restoration, God. Lord, that they would sense your presence, Lord. They would know that you will never leave them, God, that you will never forsake them. Lord, that you are always faithful, that you are always good.
No.
You're so good to us.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every
Hasn't God been good? Has your God been good? Repeat after me. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. The safest place that we can be is in the arms of the Father. Here in the presence of God is the safest place that we can be. Amen? And I want you to say one more thing. We're going to make a declaration. We're going to confess what God has said. We're going to say, when I show up, the devil has to go. You know why? It's because the Spirit of God lives inside of you. And when you walk in your authority, the devil has to go. Sickness has to go. Disease has to go. And so I want to encourage everybody watching online, everybody here today, when we show up, the devil has to go. Say it again. When I show up, the devil has to go. Amen. I bless that over you. I bless that over your home. I bless your home, people of God, LifeShare Church. Thank you. Thanks for worshiping. You may have a seat. Thank you, worship team. Wasn't that amazing? There is something about ushering the presence of God. Man, it's thick. It's thick with the Spirit of God. There's something about being together and just feeling the presence of God. There's nothing like it. We want to welcome anybody who is watching online. We're glad that you're worshiping with us. We're so glad that you, LifeShare Church, that we are gathered here together as a church family. We're excited. I'm excited about the word that the Lord has put on Ted's heart. It's a powerful word. It's going to be a word that's going to not only challenge you, but if you take it and apply it to your life, it's going to transform you. So welcome, Pastor Ted.
All right. Well, good morning. You guys look good today. You feel as good as you look? All right. I like that. So good to see you. I want to commend you for coming to the house of God today in the presence of God. Do you feel the presence of God? Man, there's nothing like the presence of God. I want to commend you for coming out. I know these are interesting times, and some of you are watching online, and we miss you, and we invite you back as soon as you're able. But again, there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ. You know, we come in a lot of different flavors. Anybody been to Baskin Robbins? Okay, you guys don't do that. You must do Häagen-Dazs, the rich folk. You know, there's a really good Häagen-Dazs place downtown. Did you know that, by the Alamo? You can nod. It's okay. This is not my message today. This is not point number one. There is a really good Häagen-Dazs place that my kids and some of my family, they really like to frequent. But nevertheless, we come in a lot of different colors, don't we? A lot of different languages, a lot of different backgrounds, all over the world. But you know what unites us? His name is Jesus Christ. Can someone give Jesus praise today? Jesus brings us all together. Doesn't matter what flavor, what language, what background, what hurts, what ups and downs. I want to tell you, Jesus brings us all together. So I really believe one day, really soon, everyone's going to be back at church. Jesus is going to heal. He's going to deliver us from this plague. We're going to be back to work, back to school. I know the kids don't want to go back to school, but that almost seems like a good thing, doesn't it? Back to school in the fall. Someone shout, back to school in the fall. So we're looking forward to that and looking forward to get back to normal. During the message or maybe at the end, we'll pray for people that are suffering with the virus. And some are in the hospital. It's not a lot of people, thank God. It may seem like a lot, but compared to the population, it's somewhere around the 1% to 2% of people that are affected. Nevertheless, when it happens to you, I'm sure it hurts and it's difficult. So we want to pray for those people. But we want to give greater thanks to God for all the people that he has already saved and delivered. Amen? Amen? You guys going to make some noise with me today? Let's give God praise for that. Come on. Josh already told me he was going to shout me down today. You didn't change your mind, did you? All right. Shout me down. It's going to be good. Well, before we get into the message, and Anna's right, I've got a word from God for you. If you're watching online, I've got a word from God for you. You need to stay watching. You need to stay tuned in. And I really believe you're going to walk away strong. You're going to walk away a better leader. And those around you are just going to really be thankful to God for what he's doing in your life. So hang on with us. But before we do that, I'm going to jump down here, and I'm going to invite Rusty and Amy Jo and Cameron, their son. Is that Cameron behind the mask? All right, come down. Give them a big round of applause. And I guess I should say the dog River. Actually, why don't you just come up here? That would be easier. Come around the back, guys. There's stairs there, and that way we can give you a good shot on the camera, and those at home can watch and meet these new fine people. Good morning. Good to see you. Good to see you. Welcome. What's up, dude? I like that mask. Looking good. What's up, Rusty? And this is River right here. That's a good dog. Well, listen, I want to give them just a minute or two to share with you a testimony of how the Lord brought them here to Life Share Church and why they've been coming for several weeks now and smiling and getting to know us and worshiping and digging in. I want them to share that. And also I'll say this, they came over to our house, the Thevaos house, with a group of leaders, I guess it was last Sunday, is that right? And just shared their heart, their story with us, and we shared some of our stories and we talked about partnership. It's not something that I asked them about. They asked me about it, although I may have asked you about it, and it kind of goes different ways like that. And but anyway, that's how it happened this way, and just want to give you the mic, guys, and just share a little bit about why the Lord has you here for this season, all right?
Fair enough. Do you want to I've heard that Ted does this to people. Just takes a shot in the dark and throws a mic in somebody's hand. So, I met these guys, Ted and the family, on Audrey's birthday. Was that last year? What birthday was that for you? You were 17 on that one? Yeah, so you're still 17? Right, okay. So they came to the Silver Spur for a horseback ride. I was the wrangler there, and they've since closed, at least for now due to COVID. But I got to meet these guys and took everyone for a ride. And I don't know, I shared quite a bit on that ride, as I often do with certain people, and the Spirit kind of, you know, makes it clear that the door is open for that. And I don't know, I guess we kind of bonded a little bit, and I got with Pastor Ted a few weeks later, I think, for some coffee. The industry that I was in, I didn't have a chance to get to church on Sundays. Raise it up a little bit. I didn't do a lot of church going on Sundays due to the industry that I was in. But when it kind of came time to end the guest ranch season for a moment, found myself in San Antonio and looking to plug into a church, and having met Ted, and everyone was closed down. All the churches were closed down. We had gone to CBC for years. They're on 1604, great church, got a lot of friends, met a lot of great people, still very close with some of them. Ended up at Crossbridge a little bit too, which is where we, near where we live, north side of San Antonio. And we've just kind of gone where the Lord has led. And with me coming out of the guest ranch industry, it was kind of Amy, you know, holding down the fort and going to Crossbridge, leaving CBC and going to Crossbridge with some dear friends that we still have in our lives. But I don't know, something about when I met Ted and got to knowing him a little bit, and then meeting the family, and you guys were the church that was open. I wanted to, it was good going online and watching CBC and some of the other places, but there was just nothing filling the gap for a family, which is what I had been missing when I had been working for several months in that industry. And so, hey, you guys had the doors open, and I wanted to come by, and if nothing else, just to kind of support a brother and be like, yeah, I know this guy, let me go and just sit in. I think I came by myself the first time or two. And long story short, just kind of kept coming, and then it was an easy sell to bring the wife, and we weren't trying to do anything. We just kind of kept doing what the Lord said to do, and Ted was very gracious in being hospitable and receiving and hearing our hearts and some of the things that God has been doing in our lives to minister to people, and that's a whole other story for another day, but we're just blessed to be here. We already feel like we're part of the family and got some good connections, and can't wait to go deeper and deeper with you guys. I'm going to land it and see if Amy wants to say anything on the way out.
Yeah, it's okay. Okay, hi. one thing that I felt like God was putting on my heart to say is this. He mentioned, you know, we'd gone to several churches. And that sounds like, oh, they're church hoppers. No, we were at CBC for about 6+ years. And when I went to Crossbridge, it was close to home. And I have this really, really close friend, still very close to, in my life. And Rusty, you know, we didn't talk about it today, we're not, but there was a lot of addiction issues. And so there was a pull to this other church. And the reason I mention this is because that ended up being a catalyst that sent him into recovery, which he's been in for a while now, since last year. So then all of a sudden God, you know, he met Ted and we started coming here. So my whole point in saying all of this is sometimes we don't understand why God takes his directions, and we think, well, I thought you said go here. There's good things happening here. And then he says, no, I want you to go here. And part of that includes trust and obedience, and even not just to God, but to my man. You know, I'd never met you guys, so I'm like, well, okay, yeah, I'm good, let's go. And because I felt strongly about where we were before, too, because of the positive things that were happening. So for me, it was like, okay, God, I really got to trust you in this to know that where you're taking us is where you want us to go, even though it seems quicker than I would have imagined, but it's not about us. So anyway, I'm very excited to be here. Went to the women's thing Friday night and super stoked and super energized and super filled with Holy Spirit and just ready to do God's work and his will. So very happy to be here.
That was fantastic. Wow. Thank you so much for just sharing your heart. And I want to pray for you, Anna, if you would join me. Actually, let's get some leader families up here. I think it's always really important to pray when people make decisions. So Josh and Jen, Tom, Michelle, Chris and Jamie, and yeah, you're fine. Just come behind them and lay a hand of blessing on them. And, you know, this is really cool today because I believe it dovetails really nicely with my message on leadership and faith. Because how many people make a decision like this in the middle of things like this, right? People are hunkering down. They're kind of waiting for the storm to pass. But you guys, in the middle of the storm, you said, hey, why don't we go walk out on the water? Let's see what that's like. Let's be a Peter. And I don't know. I just really admire stuff like that. And I believe God honors that kind of faith. So we're going to pray with you. And again, I've just been pleased to meet you guys. So let's just have fun as long as the Lord allows us. Amen? All right, let's bless them. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the Noakes family. Lord, I thank you for this man that you sent to San Antonio from Arkansas. And this woman that you sent to San Antonio from Arkansas, but they met here. Isn't that like you, God? Yeah. Just like you. You bring people from different backgrounds together to become one. And I thank you that you're making their marriage one, and you've brought their kids together and blended this family beautifully, Lord. You're strengthening their children. You're protecting their children, the ones in the military, the ones working and here and there in school. God, we thank you that you're going to meet every need according to your riches and glory. And I thank you that they've thrown their bread on the water, so to speak, and it's going to come back with jam on it. Yeah. It's coming back with blessing on it because you honor faith. God, bless them, provide for them, heal them, continue to use this couple in counseling and recovery. Lord, I thank you already for the men that are going through this purity seminar with Rusty, and I thank you that they're getting free. And we all need to be free, oh God, because he who the Son has set free is free indeed. So we pray that your anointed would come upon them in Jesus' strong name. Does anybody have a prophetic word? Come on down. 1 second, come get the mic. Thank you, Clark. Praise God. Everybody say praise God.
The Lord say that for those that are planted in the house of the Lord, they shall flourish in the presence of our God. So I see you abounding in fruit for God's purposes.
Thank you. Anything else, Anna?
The Lord just showed me a picture of the tree of life, and it's like I just saw that you guys have already dug those roots deep. And as those roots have just dug down deep into Christ and his identity, your identity in him is now flowing out of you. And the Lord says, this is a new season. He is birthing a ministry through you to bring healing to the house of God. And the word I hear is intimacy. You're going to teach intimacy to the house of God, how to be intimate with the Father to supply every need that is missing in people's lives.
Word. I've got something else I want to do. Just be praying right now. Hallelujah. Praise God. Someone say praise God. Praise God. I want to have Tom and Michelle pray. Years ago when I was at a youth camp, I found myself playing a piano and I didn't know how to play it very well. Anyway, in that moment, two men that were musicians prayed for me and kept practicing the piano, but I got a lot better, and I started writing songs, and everything happened in a moment in the presence of God through prayer, through prophetic word. And I just got this picture of my new friend Cameron standing behind this piano and us praying for him. We won't make you play anything today. We don't want to embarrass you, unless you want to, of course. But I just feel that. Tom, Michelle, can you come around here? Can you stand right here with your mask on? You just stand right there. Yeah, just right there, like you're playing it, all right? And Tom and Michelle, come around here, and you pray for them, lay hands on them. I want you to come, one on either side. Mom and Dad, come over here. My parents weren't there when I experienced this, but if they were, they would have been right behind me. So let's pray a powerful prophetic prayer.
Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you so much for Cameron, God. Lord, we thank you that you have brought him here for a reason and for a special purpose, God. Even today, God, Lord, that you are speaking to his heart, God. Lord, that you love him so much, God. That you have called him by name, God, and you have a special plan and a purpose for his life, God. Lord, and that his life will ultimately bring glory and honor to you, God. Lord, we thank you for the giftings that you have put in Cameron, God. Lord, we thank you for all of the abilities, Lord, that you've given him, God. Lord, I pray that you would flourish those right now, God. Lord, that even his heart would be set on fire with such a love for you, God, that he just has a desire, Lord, to pursue the things of God first and foremost, and then to pursue all the things that he's creative in, God, whether it's drama, Lord, theater, and music, God. Lord, I pray that he would pursue all that you have for him, God. Lord, I pray that you would bless him in every area of his life, God. Lord, that you would strengthen him. Lord, that you would give him peace. Lord, that you would give him direction. Lord, that you would lead him by your Holy Spirit, God, that he would just walk, Lord, that narrow path, God, that you've put before him, God, that he would not waver, Lord, to the left or to the right, God, but that he would follow directly behind you, Jesus, Lord. Bless him, and we thank you for him. We thank you for his life, God.
Yes, Lord, and God, Lord is seeking those that worship in spirit and in truth. And as Cameron was made, he was made to worship. He's made to worship you, God. And the Lord inhabits the praise of his people. And there's a special calling when there's an expression of the heart, in much like an art form, God, much like David. And it's not going to start on a platform. It's going to start at home. And as he's at home in his, like a prayer closet, it's also a praise closet. And it's going to start touching those keys, listening to those notes, listening to that expression of your heart. It will come out as the Holy Spirit works within you in new and creative ways that you could never imagine. So we declare these things over this young man's life. And God, you're going to do amazing things, but you're already doing it right now. So we stand firm and worship and worship and worship as we're going to bring heaven to earth. As we bring heaven to earth before, we're going to keep crying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. As we praise you, Jesus, here on earth. In your name, amen.
All right. We got one more. Slam dunk.
Yes. So Cameron, one more. I have a word for you. The Lord said that your hands are your yes. As you were playing, it's like the Spirit of God is going to fill you. And I just saw like shockwaves in the church world. And as you worship, you're going to write songs that are going to impact how worship is done in the kingdom of God. He's going to fill you with your spirit. And that's the spirit of life is going to flow through those keys into the people of God. So bless you with that.
All right. Give the Noakes family another big round of applause. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thanks for letting us minister to you. I'm telling you, I am fired up, guys. I can't wait to see what God does through this family and this young man. This is how it starts. Let us start this way with you today as well. Well, I heard this story. There was this elderly couple, and they were sitting in a swing, and they were celebrating their 60th wedding anniversary. We're not there yet, honey. 23? Who's been married longer than 23 years? Let me hear some shouts of praise. All right. There's only two of you. So I guess we're doing okay. So anyway, they're swinging away and celebrating their 60th anniversary. And the husband, he's feeling kind of romantic. And he says to his wife, honey, our love is tried and true. And she had difficulty hearing him, so she asked him to repeat himself. So he said it louder. I said, our love is tried and true. She still couldn't hear him, so she said, what? Can you please speak up? Frustrated, he said, I said, our love is tried and true. And she said, fine, I'm sick of you too. 60 years, I said. It's a long, long time to be married. And after a while, I understand things start giving out. I like hearing, but Anna has already promised me that she's going to love us, love me, and love us. Even when our hearing goes out, amen? And even when we get on each other's nerves, we're going to love each other. And anyway, seriously though, we are living in a challenging time, and people are, like I said, they're hunkered down. And I'd imagine in times like this, there's a lot of back and forth, and there's challenges. And I believe the Lord wants us to learn how to lead like Jesus. Lead like Jesus. I know older couples, they sometimes kind of bicker and fight a little bit. But they really love each other, and they're committed to each other, and they'll lay down their life for each other. They'll do anything for each other because they've made a commitment till death do us part. That's the kind of commitment I've made. That's the commitment many of you have made, and we should all make, because that's the only way marriage works and relationships work in the kingdom. And I was thinking again about our key verse that we learned last week. I want us to restate that again. It's in Mark 10:45. And let's put that up on the screen as we get started today. This is what Jesus said about his leadership mission. He said that he did not come to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many. So can we say this together? Repeat after me. For even the Son of Man came, a little bit louder, not to be served, but to serve others, and to give his life as a ransom for many. So that's why we are continuing our series on Lead Like Jesus. And I believe that if we'll lead in a loving way, others will see the leader in you. The leader in you will show. So today, what we're going to do is we're going to touch on a leadership topic that couldn't be more important during this fearful time. Many people are giving way to fear, and we can say, well, that's just understandable. Fear is okay. A little fear is good. But I had a friend that told me recently, that's not the case biblically. Actually, fear kills. Tell the person next to you, fear kills. But faith brings life. So we want to focus on faith today. There's an all-important truth in leadership that leaders do something very important. Leaders calm storms. When many are in a panic and they're terrified, what a leader does is come in by what they do and what they say to calm storms. So I want to talk to you today about the all-important topic of how leaders calm storms. You see, turbulent times are sure to come in your life. And when they do, it's imperative for a leader to be a calming and a steady influence. You've probably seen this as much as I have, but people and leaders can seem really impressive when everyone is cheering them and us on, right? But when a storm happens, it's a true test of leadership. It's really not until the storm comes that our leadership is tested. And the storms will come, won't they? In fact, we're going through a storm right now in our nation and in our world, aren't we? The storm has come. We are pressing through the storm by God's grace. And I believe Jesus wants to get you ready for the storm today. If you want to get ready for the storm, someone shout, get ready. A little bit louder. Even a little bit louder. Yeah. All right. Want to make sure you're awake today. It's time to get ready for the storm. Because we don't know when the storms of life are coming. We don't know how long they're going to last. But Jesus promised they are going to come. Because there is a battle being waged in the heavenlies between good and evil, light and darkness. Do you understand this? We have to know this. We have to pray towards this. We have to understand this when things come against us. It's not simply flesh and blood. It's a spiritual battle being waged in the heavenlies. Jesus knew this, and he sought to train his disciples to know this and to take authority of these situations. And it's my responsibility, I would say, as your pastor, and I'm honored to be your pastor, to get you ready for the storm. You don't want to be getting ready for the storm while the storm's going on. If you're already cast out from the shore and you're in a boat and the storm's here and you forgot your anchor, oops, it's a little late, right? We got to get prepared ahead of time. So that's what we're talking about today. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, Holy Spirit, let your anointing fall on me. Let your anointing, which is a gift from heaven, fall upon your people. And at the end, as we pray for first responders, teachers and students, business owners and government leaders, they're in the throes of this storm, O God, that you would indeed deliver us, O God, and rescue us and energize us and strengthen us, O God. We are crying out to you, O God, and we are studying your word so that we can be a calm in the midst of the storm. If you want that, say amen. So I want to begin by reading a story in the Gospel of Mark. It's in your Bible. And the Gospel of Mark, I told you last week, and I want to reiterate it, it's the shortest of the four Gospels. There's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Mark is only 16 chapters long. It's an action-packed gospel because it's based on the eyewitness accounts of the Apostle Peter. You see, the Apostle Peter had a bold, impetuous, brash personality. Some do, many don't. You've probably heard leaders spoken of as type A personalities, right? Driven, black and white. Yeah, that's who Peter was. He was that guy. Maybe you don't like those guys. Nevertheless, we need those guys because they lead us and they help us. But they too, like us, need some refining and training. And this is what Jesus committed to do for Peter. So there was a gentleman by the name of John Mark. He's the one who talked to Peter, and he wrote down Peter's stories, and he put them in the book of Mark. So we have John Mark. So that's the background of the book of Mark. And I want to look at how Jesus calms a storm in this story. And you're going to see in this story how Jesus moved deliberately and positively to handle the situation, instilling faith in driving out unwarranted fear. I want to say that again because you need to hear this. Write it down. This is important. As leaders, we are called to be like Jesus, to deliberately and positively handle the situation, instill faith, and drive out unwarranted fear. So I want to highlight four ways in this story of how leaders calm storms. You can write these down. They'll be on the screen. Number one, leaders calm storms because leaders care. Secondly, leaders take authority. Now, that might sound intimidating to you. That may sound authoritarian, but trust me, we need our leaders to take charge. There's nothing wrong with taking charge if it's done the right way. Leaders take authority. Thirdly, we're going to look at how leaders recite past successes. Leaders are storytellers. This helps us to visualize and conceptualize. Jesus told parables. He took his disciples to different locations, to lakes, to the Mount of Olives, to different places for them to experience and to see with their own eyes what he was talking about. Leaders recite past successes. And then fourthly and finally, we're going to look at how leaders prepare others to overcome. Does anybody want to overcome here today? Are you tired of winning? Are you guys awake today? Someone wake up. Talk to me today. My wife's going to have to shout at me up here in the front row. All right, thank you. Let's look at this story. It's in your Bible. Turn to Mark chapter 4, and we're going to look at verses 35 to 41. Mark chapter 4, 35 through 41. The story goes like this. That day when evening came, he said to his disciples, this is Jesus speaking, let us go to the other side. He's talking about the other side of the Sea of Galilee, okay? Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up. That's synonymous with a storm. It came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. Isn't that cool? Jesus just sleeps through storms. I think that's really cool. On a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, Teacher, don't you care? Don't you care if we drown? So he got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, Quiet, be still. You know, we did this during our prayer time today with the leaders. Everyone shouted, Quiet, be still. All right, let's say it like we're leaders today. Quiet, be still. Who out there are parents? Raise your hand. Proud parents, look at that. Now, I know, thank you. Excellent, a lot of parents here today. Now, I know you love your kids. You do anything for your kids. Your kids are your life, right? How do you say that in Spanish, Lalo? Mi vida, my life. I learned that last week from little Elias. Lalo kept on saying, mi vida. I said, what's that? My life. I'm like, okay, I get it. Your kids are your life. But let me be honest here for a minute. Do you ever tell your kids, be quiet? We do that, right? We take authority. Be quiet. Now here, check this out. Jesus is talking to a storm now. Be quiet. Pretty interesting. And we're going to talk about what that means for you. Some of you will say, that's Jesus. That's the Son of God. I believe that. He can talk to storms, but little old me, you know, I'm just hanging on. I'm happy I'm still alive. I want to enlarge your thinking today. I want to enlarge your faith today because I believe there's something more in this story. So what happened? The wind died down and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? They were terrified and asked each other, who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him? Who is this guy? Who is this superhero? So that's the story. And I want to dive deeper into this story. But I want to give you some background. I want you to imagine this. Do we have the picture? Okay, here's the picture. Now, you can't see the surrounding hills because the Sea of Galilee to this day, this is 2,000 years ago. We're retelling a 2,000-year-old story. The lake was surrounded by hills. To this day, it's surrounded by hills. It's 380 feet. The lake is 380 feet below sea level. And what happens is the winds will blow across these hills. And when it drops down into the water, it will create very windy conditions and storm-like conditions to where the waves are just cascading very largely. Now, understand, these disciples, they had grown up fishing. This was their livelihood. This was their life, their vida. This is all they've known. But it's interesting. This must have been the greatest storm they had ever seen because these guys are in a panic. This is not your everyday storm. This is like the storm of the century, the 100-year storm on the Sea of Galilee, because now they're in a panic. And they don't believe they can handle it. They don't know how to get through this thing. And they're pleading with Jesus, save our lives. So this is the background. And as I was thinking about this, I want to start out with this little story to segue here. I remember when, growing up, me and my family, now this is on the Vela side of the family. My name is Ted Thevaos. That's Greek. I've got four sisters, Natalie, Angela, Michelle, and Jennifer. And hopefully they're watching. Hi. Maybe not. And we grew up in the Vela family. My mom's a Vela. My dad's a Thevaos. And she took his name. I think that's really nice. But we're still part Vela. And my parents made a decision to work in the Vela family business. It was called Vela Food Enterprises, DBA McDonald's. My grandfather at some point owned several McDonald's here in San Antonio. And I grew up eating French fries and hamburgers for free, and it was the life. It was great. And but we worked. Let me tell you, if you're in a small business, right, Clark, you're going to work. Restaurant business, long hours. Ask my dad about that. It's a lot of work. But I remember when we would face storms as a family, and the word would begin to filter down from my grandparents to my parents, and even us kids, we'd begin to hear these stories. They couldn't keep them from us. And as we got older and more experienced and we started to pay attention, I would start to hear things, right? I remember getting in prayer circles with my family. And my grandmother would always pray, and she'd have a lot to say. But my grandfather would say things too, but he'd have a lot less to say. Isn't that kind of how that works? But he would say something, and I remember him saying this several times. He would say something like this: we're going to fight this. We're going to fight this. And it would do something to me and to us, and it energized the room. I'm sure it would energize my parents and his kids that worked for him. And we're talking when disease came to the family. We're talking when financial hardships came to the family. We're going to fight this. Cancer, we're going to fight this. We're going to beat this. And when things as silly as, and maybe it's not silly, someone tripped over a speed bump at McDonald's. Did they really get hurt? I don't know, but they won a lot of quick money. We got a lawsuit. We're going to fight this. You understand? And I want you to understand, in this boat with Jesus, the King of the universe, your Savior, your God, your deliverer, your example, and your leadership teacher, the greatest leader of all time, he's trying to teach his disciples something that's very important that you need to know today as you're going through the storm. Jesus has the mentality, we're going to fight this. We're going to beat this. We're going to win. It's important what you say. It's important what you believe. It's important what you do. Because others around you are watching. What's he going to say? What's he going to do? Is he going to buckle? Is he going to go to sleep and never wake up again? Is he going to show up for work? Is he going to quit? These are the questions that people want to know. So the first thing you'll notice in this story is, number one, leaders care. Tell the person next to you, leaders care. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" Did Jesus care? How do we know he cared? If he didn't care, he would have just rolled over and gone back to sleep. Said, "Good luck." But he didn't. He got up and he took care of the situation. He dispelled the unwarranted fear and he calmed the storm. We have to demonstrate for those that follow us that we care. People want to know that their leaders understand how they're feeling. God help us. God help me. Help me to listen. Help me to understand. Maybe I can't fix it, but I can stand with someone, right? Maybe I'm doing more than I know. Maybe you're doing more than you know for someone. People want to be heard. They want to be listened to. I know. I do. I need leaders to listen to me. Everybody needs a leader. We're no different. Jesus had the Heavenly Father, didn't he? We all need someone People want to know someone's in the boat with them. Someone is in the fight with them. Someone is going to fight for them. They're not alone. Listen, God is raising up a generation of leaders here at LifeShare Church that are going to be in the boat with people, going to be in the fight with people, and going to help people and not leave people alone. Amen? You guys ready to be that? Let me tell you, you're called to that. That's the mantle on this church. That's the vision of this church that's been given to me, that's been given to Anna. And I can go down the list of every leader that God has drawn here. And that's how we're going to reach people. That's how we're going to help people. That's how we're going to get through this storm. I read a story recently in the Founder's Bible. Actually, I brought it with me today. I'm really proud of this Bible. Anybody out there have a Founder's Bible? My wife reminded me of this because I told her, I said, you know, honey, I'm really believing in this election year. It's time to not start talking about politics necessarily, although politics are a necessary evil in a way, right? You got to talk about them. You got to do politics because you've got two different sides. You got to spend the money, whatever. But this is about our founding. Throughout the Bible here, there's stories of men and women of God that started this nation. And if it weren't for them, we wouldn't be here. And that's what we want to hold on. We want to hold on to the principles. If you want to grow in this election year and understand how to have good debates and good dialogue with people that are kind of missing it on some different levels, spiritually and politically, you know, listen, people need to go vote their values. You need to vote the Bible. You need to vote principle. I'll tell you that. It should be pretty simple what that is. We don't get to decide everything. We only get to choose representatives, right? Why? Because we are a representative government. We choose representatives to represent us in Washington and in Austin and the different state capitals. That's the way it was designed. And let me tell you, the only way it really works and lasts is if those leaders have virtues. And if they don't have virtues, Jesus is coming back soon, guys. And that's what we can learn, is we can learn virtues. So as I'm looking at this, David Barton, he's this historian who compiled this book. And the story that stood out to me that has relevance to what we're talking about, it's about Dr. Benjamin Rush. Let me tell you about Dr. Benjamin. He helped save many lives, American lives in Philadelphia, of the yellow fever epidemic in 1973. During the 4 months of that plague, 4 months of that plague, 10% of Philadelphians died, some 4,400 individuals. That was only 10% of the population, or I should say that was 10% of the population. There's about 44,000 people in Philadelphia living there at that time. 10% died. That's a lot of people. If we think we have it bad right now, and I know it's bad, and I know we don't want it to be worse, we want it to get better. But people have been through things before. This isn't the first storm. And this was a bad one. And often 120 bodies would be buried in a single day. No one knew at the time it was borne by mosquitoes. So people panicked and they fled the city. Many physicians became just as panic-stricken as their patients also fled. People fleeing, physicians fleeing. As a result, Dr. Rush reported that only 3 physicians were remaining in the city with 6,000 people ill with the fever. Imagine that. 6 docs for everybody. Good luck. However, like a leader that calms storms and a leader that cares, Dr. Rush refused to flee. Are you thankful for men and women of God that refuse to flee and that stand up and make a difference and care about people? Listen to what he said. And I quote, we have the quote behind me. He explained, "I have resolved to stick to my principles, my practice, and my patience to the last extremity. I am placed here by divine providence. And it pleased God to make me the instrument of saving each of their lives. That's the kind of doctor I want. I'd be proud to call Dr. Benjamin Rush my doctor. Several of his medical students perished, saving the lives of people. Dr. Rush was smitten by the virus several times, but he continued to treat his patients from his own sickbed. He had convinced his students to help him. Let's go save lives. Several of them died. He had the fever several times, but he survived. This is what I believe makes America great: caring Christian leadership. And I believe, pardon the phrase, it's what will make America great again. I didn't see that cheer back there. Honestly, this is what makes America great, is people that will lead in this type of way. So leaders care. Someone shout again, leaders care. All right, let's get on down the road here. Number two, leaders take authority. Back to the scripture, Mark 4:39 again said, he got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, quiet, be still. Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. So just as Jesus calmed both the physical storms and the storms in the hearts of his followers, leadership today requires the same kind of effort. Think about this. There's the physical storms that I believe we can pray over and we can speak to, but then there are storms in the hearts of people that we can speak to. And that's important. Sometimes I think we think, well, I can't do nothing about this big thing. So then we feel like we have nothing to do. Wait a second. No, we can speak to someone's heart. And if the heart's at peace, then they can weather the storm as opposed to being crippled by fear. We have to repress our own fears and any impulse to panic. If you're a leader, you have to repress those fears. Don't go around and tell everybody how fearful you are. It's not going to help anybody. You say, well, I'm empathizing, I'm sympathizing. Really? Think about that. Think about what you're doing. I believe many times I have to repress my own fears and any impulse to panic. I can't tell everything I'm feeling to Anna. She'd probably tell me, I don't want to hear it. Go pray and come back and talk to me with a better report. Right? She said yes. Okay, so that tells me there's no one in this world that's closer to me than Anna. It's Jesus and then Anna. And she doesn't want to hear my mess. So we have to repress things sometimes, and we got to give it to God. We have to keep our voices calm as if it's just another day at the office. No problem. Not a problem, Josh. Just another day at the office. We got this. You know, say whatever you need to say. Make light of it to get through. Really important. All right, leaders take authority. Someone say leaders take authority. I wasn't going to share this, but I'll share it really quick. I think this is funny. Several of us went skiing, and I was the one who instigated this the first time around. And it was a group of families. We went to Angel Fire, New Mexico. And I should have known to tell everybody, bring snow chains, right? And I forgot. I'll admit that. Anyway, we get out there, and there's just snow everywhere. And we've got to get to our cabin on the top of a hill. And we start driving up this hill, and the tires are spinning out. We're getting nowhere fast. And it's dark, it's cold, it's snowing, and we've got women and children, right? And we've got men that also freeze, right? So we pull into this neighborhood. It's actually a country club. It's an Airbnb, and there's a golf course, but everything's covered in snow. You can't see nothing. And as soon as I pull in, because my 4x4 wasn't working on the truck, I didn't know that. Man, I just started sliding everywhere, and then I'm stuck. Well, I call Chris and Josh, and they throw their pizza down. They were eating dinner or whatever. And they run to our rescue to help us out. And we get up to the place where we're all going to drive up the hill. And none of our cars could get up the hill. And it was cold out there. And I think Josh's car made it the furthest. We ended up making an executive decision. We're going to leave the cars down here for the night. And we're going to walk up to the cabin. So I'm the one that first one to walk up Everest, right? You know, making it up that mountain. And I got up there, and I was so cold. I was just beat. You know, we're also changing altitude, right? So you have to, is that climatize, or what is that called? Anyway. And I get in there. Thank God I find a sled. So I take a sled down. And anyway, we got a kick out of that, laughing about the sled. Anyway, the women and children came, and we walked them up there. I took several trips. Well, then at some point, we made another decision, and I was like, we're not getting our stuff. Our stuff is staying there tonight, you know. If I got what I need to go to bed, I'll sleep in my clothes, and we'll do this in the morning. And some other people chose to go get their stuff. Anyway, we kind of went our separate ways there. But let me tell you, I was so proud of these guys and my friends and our family. It's like, we didn't panic, right? Did you panic?
No, I was freezing.
He was freezing. And we laugh about this story because Chris and Josh went back down several times, and they almost got frozen on the slope. It was like a climb up Everest. So anyway, let me tell you, it's really important, all that to say, don't panic. God will bring you through. And then you have great memories afterwards. All right? So number three, leaders recite past successes. What did he say to the disciples? He said to the disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? In other words, after all that you've seen and heard me do, do you still believe I'll get you through this? What had they seen in chapter 1 of Mark, in chapter 2 of Mark, in chapter 3 of Mark? Well, let me give you a little remembrance. They had seen Peter's mother-in-law healed of a fever. Jesus lifted her up. They'd seen a demon-possessed man in church delivered. That's pretty cool. They had heard the Heavenly Father speak from heaven over Jesus. This is my son whom I love and I'm well pleased. Wow, a heavenly voice. There's all these things that were happening. They saw a paralytic man be lifted through a roof by his four faith-filled friends, and he was healed by Jesus. They'd seen all of these things. And Jesus says, and you still don't believe? You understand? I want to ask you this today as we get closer to closing. What has Jesus done in your life? More importantly, what has Jesus done in your life? That's what he had done in the disciples' life, and they had already forgotten in the midst of the storm, in the midst of the panic. Oh, wow, has God ever done anything for me? Has he ever delivered me? Their mind had quickly gone to the worst case scenario. I'm going to die. Let me tell you, this is how you keep your mind from going to the place of I'm going to die, is you have to remember the stories of how God brought you through. So shout it out really quick. How has God brought you through? Quickly, quickly. Someone shout one out. What has he done for you? Amen. What else? Protected you. Yes. What's that? Provided you a job. Vision. Healed you. What's that? Paid for your school. Praise God for that one. The parents of that young lady are very happy about scholarships. Thank you, God. Thank you, Caleb. So anyway, we have to recite these stories. So when we get our family together and everybody's panicking, what do? You get them around and say, okay, let's talk about all the times that God didn't come through. Oh, yeah, that's a great idea. No, you talk about all the good things that God did, and you forget about all that stuff, and then you feel like, I can do this. God can do this. All right, so that's what leaders do. They rehearse the stories and the goodness of God. Number four, and finally, leaders prepare others to overcome. Back in the story, Mark 4:41. They were terrified and asked each other, who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him. Who is this man? Who is this superhero? And I want to tell you this, because Jesus knew who he was, the Son of the living God, who could call angels and call the Holy Spirit to help him, he knew who he was. He knew who his heavenly Father was. The question is today, do we know who we are in Christ? Do your kids know who you are in Christ? Do your neighbors know who you are in Christ? Do your coworkers know who you are in Christ? Do they call on you when they're in a pickle? I want them to call me because I'm going to point them to Jesus. And this is what Jesus was trying to do. In other words, it was like, have you ever been in class? You show up to class, maybe you're in high school, and you got a decent grade. Well, some of you had a decent grade. You know, you were like an A student trying to keep an A GPA. Some of you were just happy to get a D, right? Anyway. And the teacher says, all right, class, we're going to have a pop quiz. What happens? Panic fills the room. Oh my gosh, I could lose my A and go to a B. I could lose my D and go to an F, and then I can't play on the football team. Oh my gosh, what am I going to do? And then all of a sudden, the reassuring words of the teacher, but students, I've got good news for you. It's going to be an open book test. And everybody's like, oh, thank God, an open book test. I think I can live today. I'm going to be able to play football. I'm not going to be punished by my parents. I'm going to live to die another day. This is what Jesus was doing. He said, I took a nap, guys, so you can tell the storm to be quiet. He said, I did all these things to show you how to deal with this stuff. Take authority over the storm. Heal this person. Pretty soon I'm going to be leaving. You remember, I'm going back to heaven. They're going to crucify me. I'm going to heaven. I'm going to come again one day. You're supposed to build the church. I'm taking a nap. It's like, oh, okay, here we go. I guess I'm not taking a nap today. You get it? It's a pop quiz. But here's the good news. It's an open book pop quiz. So you get to open up the good book, the great book, and remember the stories of the promises of God, the goodness of God, the deliverance of God, the faithfulness of God, the healing of God. It's right here, friends. It's time to get back into the good book. It's time to get back into the good book, friends on Facebook Live. It's time to get off the CNN. Was never on it. It's time to get off the Fox News. Yeah, you need to turn off some Fox News and get into the Word of God and stop just rehearsing the statistics and the facts. We don't need facts, folks. We need truth. We need freedom. We need hope. We need prayers. We need life. Because Jesus hadn't come back yet. We got to keep living. Anybody want to live today? Well, you got to grab a hold of it. You got to do like Jesus did. We're going to fight this. You got to do like my grandfather did. We're going to fight this. It's how you get through. This is how the founders got through. Final comment. We're going to pray. This is how we're going to do it. Four ways how leaders calm storms. Leaders care. Leaders take authority. Leaders recite past successes. Leaders prepare others to overcome. Jesus was preparing them to overcome. You're in church. You're in the house of God. You're in fellowship with these believers to be prepared to overcome. And I'm going to say this with boldness today. Hey, if you need to sit out for 7 days or 14 days, you go sit out for 14 days. But it's time to get back into the house of God. It's time to get back into worship. It's time to get back into fellowship again. And don't do it for Pastor Ted. Do it for Jesus. Do it for the kingdom. Do it for your family. If we're going to have revival... Did revival ever happen with one person at a time? How many were in the upper room? Come on, you guys are getting quiet on me again. How many? 120. Does that seem like a crowd? And it was women? Plus women, okay. At some point, we got to come together, folks, and we've got to worship, and we got to study the Word of God, and we got to press through these difficulties in life. Let me tell you, it's the leaders, it's the committed, it's the faithful that are going to make it through this thing. And others are going to fall by the wayside. So we need to think about these things. We need to think about what's the next month going to look like for you and your family? What's the next year going to look like for you and your family? You need God. You need the house of God. You need the presence of God. You need leaders around you to make it through this thing. Final point, story. I was watching TBN the other day, rarely do, caught a quick little testimony. There's a doctor by the name of Dr. Chauncey Crandall. He just wrote a book called Beat the Coronavirus, Fight Back. If you want to read something, I encourage you to read something like that and figure out what are your options. If you get it, what are you going to do? That seems like a great read. I'm going to order that for us, Anna. We're going to read it. We're going to look at all of our options. People need advice. We're there to give advice. And then you talk to your doctor and you make the final decision if you need it. But this is a good thing. But before that, I think this is fascinating. He wrote a book called Raising the Dead because he worked on a gentleman who died. And as he was walking out of the room, crossing the threshold of the door, the Holy Spirit spoke to this doctor. He's a graduate of Yale University. He works in West Palm Beach with a bunch of rich people down there. This guy's the real deal. You know, he doesn't just practice. He's the real deal. And he said, the Holy Spirit told him, you go back in there, doctor, and you lay hands on that man and you raise him from the dead. He's going to hell. He said, okay, God, this is crazy. He goes in there and tells the nurse, I'm going to pray for this man. The nurse says, what? Got to pray for him. Okay. She backs off. And then God says, tell that technician to put the defibrillator back on him and shock him again. It's all in the book. This is his story. Shocks the guy. The guy comes back to life. Okay? That's after he prayed for him. He prayed for him. He said, God, bring life to this man. In the name of Jesus, bring him from death to life. Something as simple as that. He talked to the gentleman later that was living and is living. And the guy said that he was taken to a very dark and lonely place. And he was getting ready to be thrown in some type of ash heap. Can't even completely describe it, but it was lonely. It was dark. It wasn't heaven. And he was scared to death. For eternity, actually. And then he heard the name of Jesus. And he said all of a sudden he was back. This is a doctor who told this story. I don't know about you, but this stuff gets me excited, folks. It's not over until it's over. How are we going to live? How are we going to talk? How are we going to speak? We need to do it Jesus' way, amen? Leaders that calm storms. Once you stand to your feet. Well, Lord, it's what you told me to say. You gave it to me because I didn't have it a few days ago, so I know it's not from me, it's from you. And as I studied that, God, you know, it corrected me, it motivated me, it helped me to be the husband and the father and the pastor and the friend that you've called me to be. And Lord, I'm honored to be able to share your word today to my church family, to my friends, and to strangers that I hope to meet. I want to say thank you, Lord, for speaking to us. Why don't you just put your hands like this? This is a sign of surrender and a sign of, Lord, fill me. God, I need you. Lord, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that you would fill your people with your presence. That you would calm them in the midst of the storm. Oh God, I raise my voices. We raise our voices and we pray for those first responders like Dr. Benjamin Rush of hundreds of years ago who lay their lives down every day. We pray that you'd protect all the nurses and doctors in our city, Begin to raise your voices. Pray for them in your own words and pray along with me. We lift them up to you. Protect them, O God. Strengthen them. Sustain them. Provide more people, O God. We pray that people would not run away from this profession, but they would run into burning buildings and sick hospitals and set people free, O God. We cry out to you. Lord, we lift up our teachers and students as many are needing to go back to school so parents can go back to work. Lord, pave the way, O God. Bless our president, vice president, governors, mayors, oh God, that they would have a vision to get people back to school and back to life, oh God, that we'd not be bound by this fear. Lord, we shake it off today. Lord, let the Church of Jesus Christ shake this thing off. Oh, Lord, you know we got to live. We've got to get through this thing. We're going to make it to the other side in the name of Jesus. Lord, we lift up our business owners right now. There's business owners in this room right now that are believing for the sale, Lord, that are believing for the next deal, oh God, and they need your intervention. They need your help. Lord, give them the cutting edge. Give them that extra advantage they need as children of God, that they would be lacking no good thing, oh God. Lord, that your children would not be begging for bread, oh God, but they would be abundantly blessed. I pray blessing over everyone watching on TV and everyone here today. Be blessed in God and go win in the name of Jesus. And finally, our government leaders, Lord, we lift them up, oh God. Lord, give us the right leaders, virtuous leaders, godly leaders, saved leaders, born-again leaders, oh God, that would lead us into righteousness and right living and eternal life in the name of Jesus. Is there anybody here today that wants to commit their life to Christ and be a follower of Jesus? Anybody? Say, I've never done that, Ted, and I kind of like what you're saying today. Raise your hand. Anybody? Anybody? All right? Okay, it's all right. If you want to do it privately, you can come talk to us. It'll be okay. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, we have something special happening today, and I don't want to embarrass her, but I want to recognize her and celebrate with Cora. Cora, you're going to get water baptized? Can we put our hands together and welcome Cora? Cora, could you come down with Laura? Laura, come with her, and I just want to introduce everybody to Cora, and as we dismiss here, we're going to go outside, and we're going to water baptize you in the tank. And who's been water baptized before? Anybody? Okay, I'm raising my hand, so we've all done it, you know, so it should make you feel comfortable. And Jesus did it, and this is the next step. You prayed with Laura, I understand, right, and committed your life to Christ. It's awesome. It's a great step, and God's going to do so many wonderful things in your life. That's cool, right? And we're going to be here to help you. Laura's going to be here to help you for, you know, as long as you need. And when you go under that water, I don't know if you've been told this, maybe Laura told you, but it's like Jesus was buried in a tomb and then he was risen 3 days later. It was a miraculous thing. He went from death to life. He was raised from the dead. And that's what happens when you go under the water. You're making a symbol that you're dying to sin and dying to yourself and this old fearful life that we all are born into. And you're raised to newness in Christ, eternal life, abundant life. And you have this, you got this channel to God now. And his spirit is going to come into you. And the Bible says he's going to make you a new creation. So this is what many of us have experienced for some few years and many years. So we're really honored to be able to do this for you, all right? All right, so Laura, why don't you take her and get changed, and we'll be right out there, and we'll do it, all right? All right, all right, all right. Why don't you go ahead and sit down a second, and Anna's got a couple things she wants to mention, then we'll receive the offering and send you off with blessing.
Ted asked me to encourage us to be a bringer. And here's, I'm going to make another bold statement. We're being really bold today, aren't we? Well, the Lord put on my heart to tell us as a church and those who are watching, the way that we are a bringer is to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. And we need to be speaking in tongues. If you have not been empowered by the Holy Spirit and allowing the Spirit of life to communicate with you and the Spirit of God, there's something supernatural that needs to happen in the city and in our lives and in our homes and in our hearts. And the way that happens is communicating with the Spirit. So I just want to make that bold proclamation to be speaking in tongues throughout the week, start with 5 minutes a day and let the Spirit of Life stir in you the courage that you need to be here, to encourage people to come, because people need to be saved. People need their lives transformed. And there is freedom in Jesus Christ. So that is my statement to the church, to be a bringer. The next thing I wanted to do is to let you know what's happening. This Wednesday, again, the girls are going to get together. There's a beautiful time that they're having growing in fellowship together. The young girls, Laura is leading that. And our girls are growing, and it's amazing. So that's going to be at our house at 6:30 p.m. And also the boys, the teen college-age boys are welcome to come as well Wednesday night. And we'll let us know if you haven't been coming and don't have any information. We'll give you that information. John Dearman will be leading that.
Awesome. Thank you, Anna. And also, if you're watching online and you'd like to commit your life to Christ, send us a private message or make it public there. If you need prayer, we like to believe God with you. So that's neat. That's exciting. At this time, final thing, I want to give you a chance to give your tithe and your offering in faith today to the Lord, and we know He's going to bless you. A quick little scripture, sow the word of God to remind us why we do what we do. There's a scripture here I'd like to read, if we can go to that one. Malachi 3:10 says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be that there may be food in my house. And try me now on this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. So as you give abundantly, the Lord's going to bless you and multiply what you give. So let's do that now. And very good. If we pass the baskets. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for worshiping with us today. We're going to go out and do the water baptism now. God bless you. Love you. Bye-bye.